I'm on a quest to investigate a mysterious pattern of rocks discovered under Lake Michigan that some are calling America's underwater Stonehenge. I've seen the original Stonehenge up close myself. It's a mysterious site in southwestern England that's even older than the Egyptian pyramids, dating to about 5,000 years ago. It's a megalithic structure made of massive rocks weighing as much as 50 tons each. The rocks are stacked on top of one another and arranged in a giant circle. So it's clear that Stonehenge is a man-made monument. But the origin of these stones in Lake Michigan is less obvious. While they do seem to form a perfect geometric shape, they aren't stacked or connected in the same way.
And while there is evidence that prehistoric tribes roamed the Great Lakes for thousands of years,
very little is known about them, and I haven't seen anything remotely resembling this formation in the archaeological record. So if this is man-made, who would have made it and why? Once we're out in open water, we're allowed to take off the blindfolds and turn the cameras back on. So I join underwater archaeologist Mark Hawley on the top deck to find out why he thinks this discovery is so important.
Tell me a little bit how you found it.
We were looking for a shipwreck. All of a sudden, this line of stones comes up. We had no idea what it was, other than it didn't look to be natural. It looked to be artificial.
One look at the outline of the rocks was all it took to convince tribal elder Hank Bailey that this is a ceremonial site. Hank's ancestors, the Anishinaabe people, were among the first to inhabit this area. He believes his tribe's prehistoric forefathers, hunter-gatherers who settled this area after the last ice age, placed these stones here for a sacred purpose.
Why is it so important to you?
Anishinaabe culture, we refer to stones as animate objects because they come from the mother, the earth, who is alive. We refer to them as Mishumas, grandfather. They reinforced that we have been here a long time, and that's why we've been so particular with your crew about the location.
But how could a site 40 feet underwater be sacred ground?
It's unlikely an ancient civilization would have dropped six stones into such a perfect arrangement from boats on the surface. But could it be possible that in the time of Hank's ancient ancestors, this lake bed was high and dry?
If so, the possibility that this site is man-made is more likely.
When I started researching this story, I knew the size of the Great Lakes had fluctuated over time, just not how much they changed or when.
So I met up with local expert Brian Price to find out more. Brian has been studying this part of the country for decades, and he's not the least bit skeptical about the presence of a man-made rock formation beneath Lake Michigan.
Lake levels have changed drastically, been much higher, and then much lower, and then much higher again.
Brian explains that when the glaciers from the last ice age began to melt, Lake Michigan started to swell. But when the melting ice exposed a new channel to the St. Lawrence River, the meltwater drained off and the lake shrunk dramatically.
If you look at the type of beach, the rocks, it's exactly the same thing replicated that you would have been seeing 5,000 years ago back at the base of the other bluff.
Yeah.
What happens is the waves keep undercutting the bluff and moving it back, leaving behind the big rocks, taking away the sand and the gravel and all the little stuff that can be moved, and pushing it out into deeper water. And so what you've got is this terrace, and where the water paused underneath what's current shoreline, you might find the same pattern of a little wave-cut bluff, and then a terrace below it, wave-cut bluff, terrace below it, wherever the water was for a significant period of time to rework that shoreline material.
So essentially, you got this big flat plain that the lake is covering up.
Right.
So people could have been walking out there 40 feet underwater now, but on dry land.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So based on Brian's research, it's entirely possible that humans could have built this site. But the question remains, did they?
Mm-hmm.
As a scientist, I know the only way to determine the true nature of this site is with empirical evidence. So I need a close-up view of the rocks. And not just the flat sonar images I've seen from above. I need to see them from below.
We got two propellers in the back. We got a propeller on top, propellers on the sides.
So a member of Mark's team helps me prep the camera-mounted ROV, or remotely operated vehicle. This one, nicknamed Jake, is fully loaded with three cameras, a grasping claw, measuring lasers, and GPS navigation. It can withstand the frigid water temperature of Lake Michigan better than any human, and it can dive to 1,000 feet deep.
All right, looks like we're in a good place, so we're gonna go down. So we are on the bottom.
The ROV gives me a much closer look at the site than the radar scans. As a marine biologist, I've spent a lot of time exploring underwater this way. And at first glance, no obvious traces of human presence jump out at me. But one stone in particular has drawn special attention from Mark's team.
I think that might be our stone here.
Because they think it has a carving etched onto its face.
You can see it looks pretty rounded off, so I think it's this face right here, this line here, I think makes up the potential carving.
Finding a carving would confirm that this site is man-made and open up a whole new set of questions. But the resolution from the ROV's camera isn't sharp enough to tell for sure.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it is really hard to see. I mean, it's somewhat low res. It's hard to tell right now. I think what we're gonna have to do is get in the water.
We don't excavate anything, we're not touching anything, we're just going down, looking, taking pictures.
Okay.
Mark and Hank have agreed to allow just one dive to the site.
Now I'm amped.
If I'm going to solve the mystery of this underwater Stonehenge, this is my one shot. For one thing, the geological record indicates this site, now 40 feet underwater, may have been on dry land for millennia after humans arrived here. And archaeological evidence suggests this area was inhabited by prehistoric Americans long before that. But most striking are the images from our ROV camera that show what could be a man-made carving on one of the rocks.
Could this be some of America's oldest artwork, or just another random act of nature? There's only one way to find out.
Out a series of indentations that could be a carving, but the visibility is too poor for me to tell for sure. So I'm going to try out a new piece of technology that sees the rock better than I can. An advanced technique called stereophotogrammetry, and it allows scientists to create 3D models from two-dimensional photographs.
I'm convinced there's something peculiar at the bottom of Lake Michigan.
Hopefully, the 3D model will give me the tools I need to determine the truth about these rocks once and for all. If this site really was made by man, it must have served a specific purpose. So what could it be?
I know that several early cultures used stones to track the position of the sun and the stars in the sky. In fact, there's a well-known stone formation in Wyoming called the Medicine Wheel, where the rocks align with certain stars on specific dates of the year. It was an effective tool to predict when the summer solstice would occur, allowing native people to better time when to harvest their crops. Could that be what's happening with these rocks right here in Lake Michigan?